are some of the symptoms of stage 2 colorectal cancer? What does treatment look like for it? In today's video, I'm going to be talking with stage 2 survivor Allison about these questions, plus how she decided to become active in the colorectal cancer world. This video is part 2 in a special series that I'm doing for Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month this year, where I'm talking with survivors that have been diagnosed with this crappy disease from stage 1 all the way through stage 4. Before we dive into the interview, let me introduce myself to you really quick. My name is Jelena, and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer at age 34. I created this channel to talk all about colorectal cancer, what treatment is like, and how life just doesn't return back to normal once treatment is over. If you like what you're hearing so far, feel free to click on the subscribe button below here and click on the bell to receive the notifications when my latest videos are uploaded. Now let's get into my interview with Allison. So welcome, Allison. First, can you tell us a little bit about yourself pre-cancer?
Sure. And my name is Allison Rosen. Pre-cancer, let's see. It's hard to remember because I've changed so much, but I was working in cancer research before I was diagnosed. So I'd worked in cancer research since 2005. So I had a very big interest in cancer and what, you know, what was involved in it. Hobbies included dancing, going out with friends, sort of living life to the fullest. I love to travel. You know, I think I lived a life that was just really fun and exciting, and cancer was definitely never on my radar.
Talk to us about the symptoms that you experienced leading up to your diagnosis, and how long from those first symptoms until you were diagnosed?
I want to say about 6 months before I was diagnosed, I started having symptoms that I couldn't necessarily explain. So first of all, I was doing Zumba all the time. So I thought my weight loss was from Zumba. So that I was like, okay, I explained that with the fact that I was exercising. I think the sheer exhaustion, I was really fatigued and exhausted. I also thought maybe that was because I was picking up my exercising and really trying to become as healthy as possible. The blood in my stool, so I have Crohn's disease. It had been in remission at that point for quite a few years. So blood in my stool was not necessarily abnormal, but I had a lot more blood in my stool than I normally ever did. And so I just sort of saw that, was a little bit worried. I think for me, the big symptom was my change in bowel habit. So I was relatively aware of, you know, going regularly and whatnot. And so I started maybe going more often. It was maybe a little bit more painful. What was coming out looked a little bit different. I also felt like every time I ate, something was getting stuck inside of me. And that was just a little bit weird because no one believed me when I said that. I was like, well, I feel like I'm eating something and it's just getting stuck, like right where the colon sort of is. It just feels like it's getting stuck there. And that would cause, you know, some pain and constipation. And I was going regularly. I was never constipated. So some of that sort of inconsistency with my bowel habits were sort of the main symptoms I had. I was definitely more anemic than usual because I had been previously anemic, but I had basically been normal for a long period of time. And so I had a blood test and it showed I was anemic, and that sort of maybe would explain, you know, the blood loss was causing maybe the anemia. And I saw my doctor, and my doctor was like, well, maybe it's nothing. Let me do an x-ray. So I got an x-ray and she listened to all my symptoms, and she thought that maybe I had a blockage of some sort. So the x-ray showed that, yeah, there was some bowel sort of stuck inside of me that wasn't necessarily moving. So she thought what would help is if I drank some, you know, citrate magnesia or the magnesium citrate, sorry, wrong one. So I drank some magnesium citrate, and they thought that would help sort of move whatever was stuck inside of me out, and the discomfort I was having and the bleeding and all that would go away. For about a day, I maybe felt a little bit better, but then it just came back and it was even worse. And so I talked to my doctor and she was like, well, we can schedule a colonoscopy for about, you know, 3 months from now. And so I was, you know, satisfied with that initially. And then I went out of town and was eating just with friends and got really, really ill. And when I came back, I called her and I'm like, listen, this isn't going away. It's getting worse. There's definitely something wrong. I'm not quite sure what it is. And so she scheduled my colonoscopy for a few weeks after that. So I didn't have to wait the full 3 months. It was mainly just like a month after. So I want to say total, it was probably about 6 or 7 months before I had that colonoscopy that was eventually led to my diagnosis.
Okay. Now with your Crohn's disease, did you have a colonoscopy to diagnose that? And were you getting regular colonoscopies because of that?
That's what's scary to me. I had had the cleanest colonoscopy I'd ever had a year and a half earlier of my diagnosis. So I wasn't thinking anything of it because, you know, my colon's always been crappy. I've always had a pretty, no pun intended. I've always had a pretty bad GI system, but I had been on medicine for a while and everything had been stable for a while. And a year and a half earlier, I'd had a great colonoscopy where they showed me the pictures, everything looked fine. So when I was eventually diagnosed, it obviously for me and for her, she said it must have been aggressive and maybe they missed it, who knows, but also ultimately it was that tumor that was blocking anything from moving down my colon.
Wow, okay. So then you ended up being diagnosed during your colonoscopy. So what was your official diagnosis?
Well, so I had the colonoscopy and I woke up and she's like, well, I found something. I'm not quite sure what it is. There's something growing. So I have to do a biopsy before I can tell you for sure. So 2 days later, she mentioned cancer. And so that was in the back of my mind for, you know, essentially 2 days leading up to that phone call. Then she called me and asked me to come to her office. And I knew at that point when she called that she was going to diagnose me with cancer, even though I was, again, I had, was like, wait, someone my age shouldn't get cancer. This is just weird. I don't get it. So when I got that diagnosis, my life flashed before my eyes. And I really thought I'm going to die. Like that was sort of the first thing that came to my head. I was initially diagnosed with stage 3 colorectal, and my tumor was in like the very bottom part of my colon and my rectum. So it was a 13-centimeter tumor. And then some lymph nodes were inflamed in the initial scans and everything. It wasn't until later that it was downgraded to stage 2 because inflammation in my lymph nodes was not cancer. Thank goodness. So I was actually, I say lucky, but I feel like not many people get their diagnosis or their staging downgraded, but I did. So I was very happy about that.
So initially when you started treatment, they were treating you as though you were stage 3, or were they treating you as though you could potentially have been stage 2?
They were treating me as stage 3 at first.
Okay. So then what did your treatment plan look like?
So I guess standard of care at that point was I did chemo and radiation, and then they let my body, and I did that for 5.5 weeks, and then they let my body rest, and then I had surgery. And so I had lots of different surgical options and saw many different people, but ultimately I wanted, if possible, to not have a permanent ostomy. And so the surgery was decided to go in and, you know, take what they can and form a J pouch, which is an internal pouch where they take out part of the colon and they stretch your colon and whatever's left of your colon, rectum, sort of ileum area and create an internal pouch. So I had that initial surgery where they created that J pouch, and I had a temporary ileostomy for a while. And then I went back, as I was healing, I did chemotherapy again. And then I had my second surgery to reverse and sort of put me back together. That was sort of my treatment plan.
So then when did they determine that it was actually stage 2? Was that at your surgery that they decided that? Okay.
Yeah, at that first surgery. So instead of having IV chemo follow-up from that surgery, I was able to do oral chemo.
Was it Zolota again that you did? Okay. Yeah. And is that what you did with the radiation?
Yeah.
All right. So how long did you take the Zolota?
I should remember. I think I also did, I'm sure it's written somewhere, I should know this by heart, but I think I did it for a few weeks as well. Maybe 3 months, actually, maybe more than a few weeks, maybe like 3 months. I do remember, I don't remember the exact time point, but I do remember the last dose was Super Bowl Sunday, whatever year that was.
Okay. Cool. So when you did the Zolota after surgery, did you do like a week or two on and a week off kind of thing? Because I've heard of that. Can you explain exactly what you did?
I think it, if I remember correctly, it was a week on, a week off. And I think that was over the course of, like I said, a few months. And then every few weeks or so, I would talk to my doctor about my symptoms and what was going on and if he thought it was okay to stop it. Because even though they had a set time they wanted me to do it, they were willing to stop it early if my neuropathy or other symptoms got really bad.
So you mentioned that at your initial surgery, you ended up with a J pouch. So can you talk about your experience with that and then your following surgeries?
Yeah, so the J pouch for me was what I wanted originally. And I was very happy that my surgeon agreed to do it. But ultimately, because of my Crohn's, even though it wasn't active, I had a lot of inflammation of the pouch, called pouchitis per se. So I was in and out of the hospital quite a bit for probably 2 years off and on. And ultimately something happened that led to me having to have a temporary ileostomy again. And that led to the decision to make that ileostomy permanent about 4 years ago. And ultimately, anyone with Crohn's or any sort of IBS, Crohn's, colitis, a J pouch is probably not the best thing because Crohn's can attack anything, no matter where it is in your body. And we really think that's sort of what was going on. My Crohn's, it hadn't been active, was sort of awakened by whatever surgical, you know, stuff I had. And it sort of was causing really bad inflammation. And so it was, you know, very similar to what people call LARS. Like I was on the toilet all the time. I couldn't control my bowels. It was just, it was a nightmare. It was very hard to live every day and try to work every day. I had to know where the restroom was all the time. And on my way, I would drive to work. It would maybe take me 10 minutes to go to work, but I would have to stop at, you know, I knew where every McDonald's was because I knew their bathrooms would usually be open, maybe not clean, but accessible to the public. So it's one of the hardest times. I mean, there were lots of hard times throughout my cancer journey, but when I was trying to get, my body was trying to get used to not having a colon anymore, because they did remove my whole colon, because they said when they did surgery, because of years of Crohn's, it basically just fell apart in their hand. So they had like sort of the bottom part of the colon into the rectum that attached to my ileum. So okay. It was rough. I have a lot of respect for people that deal with LARS on a regular basis because it's not easy. And I really had to watch what I was eating all the time. Said it was rough.
Okay, so then what led you to go from the J pouch to the ileostomy? Was that all your choice or did something happen that kind of let the pieces
fall? Unfortunately there was an accident, and so there was a puncture that happened during a procedure. So it happened, there was an abscess that formed. They were hoping that the abscess would heal in a way that maybe I could keep the J pouch, but ultimately after talking to my surgeon, it was the best decision that could be made to have that temporary ileostomy while everything healed. And in those 2 years while I had that temporary ileostomy, my, I think, opinion changed on having an ostomy, because I was very much, again, at the beginning, adamant that I didn't want it because I was single and was dating and I didn't want anything external. But those 2 years, I got my life back. I really like was able to live fully, work, be very productive. I went on a surfing trip with other young adults that were going through cancer, and they helped me name my ostomy. And I realized if I could surf with this, I could do anything with it. And it was really, you know, essentially, I say my companion, but essentially it was a part of my body now. And so when I had the difficult conversation with my surgeon about making it permanent or, you know, possibly going back to reversing it, he was like, I wouldn't suggest reversing it. Otherwise you'll be attached to a toilet for the rest of your life. So it was a no-brainer for me to have that surgery to, you know, to make that ileostomy permanent, because my quality of life was just so much better. So I know it's a personal decision for people, but I do urge anyone that's thinking about whatever their surgical options are. And if someone talks about an ostomy, my surgeon originally said he wanted to do as little surgery as possible. So obviously they want to have one surgery that's successful they don't have to go in. So essentially I ended up with 3 open surgeries and a ton of scar tissue on the inside and a ton of complications because of that scar tissue. So if I had maybe talked to other ostomates or learned a little bit more at the beginning, it would have saved me a lot of pain, suffering, and, you know, long-term side effects that I'm dealing with and I will be dealing with for the rest of my life if I had had that ostomy made at that first surgery.
So has living life with the ostomy been different than you imagined it would be?
Exactly what I just said.
Yeah.
It's great. Like I love my ostomy. Like it gives me a freedom that I didn't know that I'd be able to have even before the cancer. My Crohn sometimes would, you know, years before when I was younger in my teens, my Crohn's would stop me from doing certain things. There are certain foods I couldn't eat. And yeah, you have to watch certain foods with your ileostomy. You know, there are certain things you have, dehydration is an issue or whatnot, but I can go on a road trip and be in a car for 12 hours and eat. And the freedom to be able to do that is worth, I mean, not just that, there's lots of things, but just the simple things in life that I'm able to do that this ileostomy, now I call Phil, F-I-L-L, lets me do it was life-changing. And it made me very, very proud of my body and what I've gone through. And I'm grateful that this ostomy, you know, and ostomy, ileostomy, colostomy, all this stuff exists. Because if it didn't, I don't know if I'd be alive today.
How long have you had your ostomy for?
So this is my third and my final, but this one I've had now for about 4 years.
Okay. So you mentioned you went like on a surfing trip with some other survivors. Was that with First Ascents?
Yes. Yes. Okay. So someone told me about, I got involved at MD Anderson where I was treated on a young adult advisory council where they take our feedback and they listen, which is crazy. I never thought that my story or my experiences could help others. When I was on that council, one of the girls told me about sort of a life-changing trip for her. And I looked into it and I was like, I've never gone surfing. I've always wanted to try it. So I signed up, I went, and really that trip changed the whole trajectory of my experience. I really think that it made me confident in my body, which I wasn't at that point with the ostomy. It made me confident with my scars. It made me realize that I could do anything I wanted to do. And the ostomy wouldn't stop me. And cancer in general wouldn't stop me. So these 11 people that were on my trip who are still my great friends really helped me. And all of our counselors and the organization in general just helped me realize that life, I could live life and I could have a happy, fulfilled life no matter what.
Awesome. Great. So what made you decide to become an advocate for multiple colorectal cancer organizations and become active with them?
It's a good question. So for me, again, I said I was working in cancer research sort of at the time when I was diagnosed. I still went back to that job after I got better and was in remission. And so I went on a trip, again, with a group of adolescent and young adults at MD Anderson. We went on this zoo trip. I just wanted to connect with others. That was my first initial thing. Because I had no idea other young people like me existed with cancer in general, let alone colorectal cancer. So I went on this trip and I got involved with them. And once I got involved with them, I learned again about so many other opportunities that were available. And so there was a male colorectal cancer survivor on our council that told me about Fight CRC and Colorectal Cancer Alliance and Colon Cancer Coalition. And I went to Google and I said, colon cancer support or nonprofits Houston. So the first group I actually got involved in was the Colon Cancer Coalition, because they had a Get Your Rear in Gear Houston down the street from where I lived. So I did that race with my friends and family. I think this was right when I'd finished my first or second surgery. So I wasn't able to run, but I was able to walk. And it was the first time I'd ever met another colorectal cancer survivor. And it was empowering and it was just amazing. And connecting with them and realizing about all the available, you know, resources that were out there just sort of started the whole trajectory of me getting involved. And the more involved I got, the more I realized that my story could make a difference and help others. And the more I wanted to do it. So, I mean, it just made sense. I'm it's weird because I'm not a public speaker. I wasn't a public speaker before, but I told my story to a group of medical students at Baylor, where I used to work at Baylor College of Medicine here in Houston. And telling my story in front of them was the first time I hadn't cried telling my story. And just the feedback I got from them was so helpful that, again, it was just like, I want to do more. I want to do more. And so I was a Fight CR ambassador, and I loved it. And I got invited to join the Never Too Young Advisory Board for Colorectal Cancer Alliance. And anything that had to do with young and colorectal cancer, I was just like, yes, I want to. And it was really to meet people. I just wanted to meet other people and feel like I had a community where I fit. I didn't know where I belonged anymore. I really was like lost. I love my friends and family, but the only people that I feel like can truly understand and I can talk to about some of the gory things that I was going with was someone else that was going through the same journey as me.
Yes. Yeah. And you don't feel bad about talking about those things. Sometimes you feel bad, like telling your family or friends about like some of these dark things that you're going through, because you don't want them to feel sorry for you or be upset. So yeah, talking to someone else that's been through it, really, they know. So they're like, yes, yes, hugs. Yes. Exactly. I know exactly what you're feeling.
It was like these people were instantly my best friend and just understood me better than I understood myself, because they had already gone through it. So anybody listening, if you are not involved or you've not met other people, do it. It will change your life. Like, hands down, it changed mine in so many ways.
So you've been making TikTok videos lately about colorectal cancer awareness. So how did you get into that?
It all started with COVID. Truthfully, I'm on all the other social media channels and I'm pretty active. And I'd sort of heard of TikTok, but I thought it was just for kids. And so COVID happened and I was very bored. And then with everything that happened with COVID and the delay in screening for colorectal cancer, you know, all the estimates out there, I transitioned jobs. So now I work in cancer prevention and health disparities and public health. So just everything that was going on in my work, as well as in the community with the delay in colonoscopies and the, you know, them possibly lowering the screening age to 45 and the increase in cancer in the younger population, I realized, okay, where else can I go to share information about colorectal cancer that would benefit people? So I was like, okay, I'll check out TikTok. And I rolled my eyes. I rolled my eyes because, like I said, I thought it was for younger people. I got on and I was like, wow, this is great. I love this. And I had time. Like, I'm usually really, really busy. And, you know, I couldn't go to meetings anymore. At the beginning of COVID, the meetings that I was involved in local and even nationally, a lot of them were canceled, at least for the time being, until they figured out the whole virtual thing. So I had a lot of free time. So when I got on TikTok, I did some searches on hashtags, tried to figure it out a little bit. And I did one of my first colorectal cancer videos. And I think at that point, maybe I had 50 followers max, and it got thousands of views. And I'm like, wow, okay, there must be a need for this on TikTok, on this platform. And slowly but surely, the more I made, the more I connected with people that were survivors, were patients, were caregivers, or had questions. I mean, I got a lot of questions about the signs and symptoms and whatnot. So essentially COVID, there's not a lot of great stuff that's come out of COVID, but for me, getting on TikTok was definitely a plus. And now actually, as of, I think 2 days ago, I've now have 10,000 followers, which is amazing.
Wow.
And it's insane that people actually want to listen to me.
That's great. And you mostly just talk about colorectal cancer stuff, correct?
Yeah, mainly colorectal. I did a few things on the COVID vaccine and how I was a cancer survivor and getting that. Mm-hmm. So taking sort of the hot topics as they relate to cancer. So the trends that are on TikTok, you can do those dances and still say 1 in 24 are diagnosed with colorectal cancer. And then it sort of develops as people ask questions. That's where I get, you know, what content that I put out.
Awesome. Well, that's great to hear that you're really reaching a lot of people with these, and you're active on all your social media platforms too. So I'm sure you've got lots of followers elsewhere too. Yeah. I mean, is TikTok the most popular one?
Oh yeah. 10,000 is the most followers I have for sure. I think that, I mean, I do I do Twitter to mainly connect with the medical community that I work with, but also that I volunteer with and whatnot. And there are a lot of survivors on Twitter as well. So I really, the goal with Twitter is to sort of help bridge that gap between the survivor and patient community and advocate community and then the medical community. And so it's great. I've connected with so many people there. I mean, Facebook and Instagram are both just to reach, obviously my friends and family. I still connect with all of them, but it was really, social media was a really good way to get some information out there when I was going through treatment. So I didn't have to answer all those emails and all those phone calls when I just didn't feel like it. So I shared certain things on there. And again, it's the amount of support you can get on Facebook is just insane. There's neighborhoods, there's groups, there's so much. And I had a question about swimming with an ostomy, and I posted it when I first had that question years ago. And I think I got 100+ responses, and there's nowhere else you can go. And instantly you get all those answers from people that are experts because they have been there.
Well, that's all the questions that I have for you. Is there anything that came up while we were talking that you want to discuss or anything else that you thought of?
I think the one thing that I love for people to take away from this is that cancer does not define you. Just because I became a very passionate advocate doesn't mean you have to, but if you want to, there is space for everyone to do so. I think every story, every experience, every, you know, journey that people go on needs to be shared so that people can hear how, I guess, widespread colorectal cancer is. I think people don't know that people like you and me can get it. We don't look like the typical. I don't think there is a typical colorectal cancer patient. And so, breaking that norm and sharing your story is going to help so many people. And like I said, I was shy before all this. I'm definitely not shy now. And it's changed the person that I am today. I'm not happy that I got cancer, but I took what I got through my journey and my cancer story, and I changed my life for the better. And now I love my job and I love advocacy, and it gives me a purpose in life. So I took a bad and made it, essentially a positive as far as impact that I could do to help others.
Thank you so much, Allison, for taking the time to share your story with us. If you enjoyed hearing her story, click on the like button below over here to show her some love. Keep tuning in every Friday this month to hear my interviews with a stage 3 and a stage 4 survivor. And if you happen to have missed my video last week where I interviewed stage 1 survivor Evan, click on the video up here. Or you can click on the video down here, and that's a video that YouTube thinks you'd really enjoy watching from my channel. Thanks for watching.